Good morning. Morning. Welcome to CCC. Let's all stand. We're singing Open the Eyes of My Heart. Here we go.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy.
Sing holy, here we go.
Holy, 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 holy.
Holy, here we go.
Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you.
Here we go, hands. Here we go. Two, three, go.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy. Power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy.
Here we go.
Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you.
Keep singing holy. Here we go.
Holy, holy.
Terry.
Oh, you want me to say it?
Here's Terry.
I'm working on it.
Let's remain standing for a word of prayer, please. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for all of our yesterdays, and thank you for any tomorrows that we may have. Thank you for the blessings that you give us each and every day. Thank you for the ability to come and worship you without too many fears of our safety. And thank you for the opportunity to better experience and share your love. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. If you have not already done so, please silence your cell phones. Today, Pastor Mark will be delivering the sermon, Is Believing in God Enough? The second in his series of My Step with God Is, with 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 8 as the scripture reading. Is believing in God enough brings to mind a story I heard recently about this Protestant gentleman who was the only Protestant in a Catholic neighborhood. He was completely surrounded by Catholics, and they were constantly trying to get him to convert to Catholicism. So after several months of this happening, he finally gave in. He said, okay, and he went to see the local priest. The priest said, it's not a problem. It's a real simple process. He sprinkled water on him and said, you were born a Protestant. Sprinkled some more and said, you were raised a Protestant. Sprinkled some more and says, now you are a Catholic. So the next Friday, the priest comes walking down the street and he sees the man out in his backyard grilling this nice, great big ribeye steak. And he says, there seems to be some mistake here. You don't understand that on Fridays, we Catholics don't eat red meat. The man said, okay. He sprinkles some water on the steak and he says, you were born a cow. Sprinkles some more on it and says, you're born a cow. Sprinkles some more on it and he says, now you are a fish. Pastor Mark, thank you for your service that we're going to have. Danny?
I don't even have a follow-up to that, Terry. I'm trying to think of something snappy. Snapper. I think something snapper. Here we go. Let's all stand. I'm going to go back a little bit, sing Shout to the Lord.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
My Jesus.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. Sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in. Nothing compares to the promise I have in. Nothing compares to the promise I have in.
Go ahead and have a seat. We introduced this song last week. It's called Gratitude.
Got nothing new. How could I expect?
my gratitude. I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. I've got one response, I've got just one move. With my arms stretched wide, I will worship you. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. Nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord.
Sing that again, here we go.
Come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, up your song, cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah.
So the other day, in front of my house, one of those street cleaners was going by, you know, those big trucks with the wheels on the side and the big brush in the back. When I was a kid, I was deathly afraid of those things. I was so scared when one comes to the street, I'd run into the backyard because it was big and monstrous and loud. Isn't it funny that we fear these things that are often good for us? And, you know, I was a child back then. I know those are good for us. Kept the streets clean and for sanitation and all that. And isn't that the way it is with God sometimes, that we fear him, we fear what he has in store for us when we know we shouldn't. And we grow from there. In fact, it's normal to be fearful. I mean, at Jesus' tomb, I'm reading from Mark, it says, as they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in white robes sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. And the man says, don't be alarmed. And didn't the angels say to the shepherds, don't, you know, fear not? So we're always being commanded not to fear, yet we still do. So we need to make sure that we keep Jesus as our way maker to get rid of the fear in our lives. Because we know that what he has in store for us is good. So we just need to drop those fears. Those are all fabricated in ourselves. So let's drop those
and just find the way that Jesus leads to. Here we go.
That is who you are, that is who you are.
Lord, you are the great way maker. You get rid of our fears, Lord, and bring us into the light. And you have everything in store for us, Lord. Just open our eyes to see what you have for us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for bringing Pastor Mark this for the message this morning, and open our hearts for those for the message, Lord. Just fill us with the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we prayed, because is it his name, because ours are not worthy. We all prayed. Amen. Go ahead and have a seat. Have the scripture reader up, please.
Hey, good morning, everyone. Well, the lights went down. Is it nap time when John comes up here? You know, it's great to be home. There's no place like home. You know, I've been gone for the past 2 weeks, traveling on spring break and post-spring break trips, so I really miss all you guys. Which movie was it that made There's No Place Like Home famous?
Wizard of Oz.
Wizard of Oz, very good. Wizard of Oz and Dorothy. And while I was sitting back there, I was thinking of other iconic quotes in history. How many golfers do we have in this group here? Oh, there you go. It's on this side over here. So you hook then. So as you know, this week is the Masters. So you probably have heard a tradition unlike any other. That's the Jim Nance tagline for the Masters. Who's winning the Masters right now anyway? Okay, I won't say anything. John Yoo. Or I was thinking about this morning. With great power comes great responsibility. Spider-Man, Uncle Ben to Peter Parker in Amazing Fantasies number 15. I'm a comic book geek and a Spider-Man fan. But the most iconic quote I've heard is from our own Pastor Mark. You know, a couple of months ago, we had a meeting at a restaurant, and then I listened to last week's service, and Pastor Mark said it again, "It ain't a meeting without eating." I thought that's fabulous, and I've stole that tagline, Pastor Mark. So if I'm up here next week, we'll talk more about food. Hear the word of the Lord. This morning's scripture reading is from the second book of Peter, chapter 1, verses 3 through 8. His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us his very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness, knowledge, and to knowledge, self-control, and to self-control, perseverance, and to perseverance, godliness, and to godliness, brotherly kindness, love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Thank you, John.
Good morning, everybody. Well, if that's my legacy, I'm going to be known for it ain't a meeting without eating. I guess that's okay. Anyway, I'm here without my wife today, and that's too bad for us, but she's with the grandkids, and there's something special at their church, so I'm flying solo today, and good for her. It's a happy event up there. Today we're going to be talking about beliefs. And it's an interesting topic because we all believe different things, don't we? Yeah, when it comes to Christianity, we all believe certain things that sort of we rally around. But I wonder, what do you believe? What are the real beliefs that drive your life? You wake up in the morning and you still believe this, or you still believe that. One of the problems I think we're facing in culture these days is we're kind of told what to believe. The voices of the media, social media, and mass media are so powerful, they're so noisy, and there's such a bias in that, that it gets to us, and there's an agenda behind what they're saying. You already know those things as you've studied the power of media also, but it's dominant, especially social media. And I have a picture up here. Actually, I think I left my laser in my pack there. Maybe somebody could grab it for me. I don't know if you're, how many of you have Netflix subscriptions and you watch some things on Netflix? A couple of years ago, I think it was 3 years ago, there was a program on Netflix called The Social Dilemma. And it was remarkable and powerful. We watched it, and it was an expose, actually, exposing the motives of these big internet companies like Facebook and Twitter, which is now X, and Google and Instagram, Snapchat, TikTok, all those. They have a certain agenda, and their agenda is meant to drive home certain beliefs that we should hold, and they gradually saturate your mind with these beliefs. We don't really feel it happening maybe day to day, but as time goes on, it certainly has a massive influence on beliefs. In fact, the show was explaining that there are statistics proving that hostility and violence and even bullying in schools has risen dramatically since these four or five companies have had such a massive influence on our on readership and viewership. We read, watch these things on our phones. And we have, if you have a PC and on your television, there's different ways to internalize these views and these beliefs. And it's especially disruptive to teenagers, especially young teens, especially young female teens. There's an alarming increase in a depression and anxiety and even suicidal thoughts. And it's created this sort of performance-driven view of life. I have to do better than these people around me are doing, and it's rushing people toward an unrealistic view of life, and it's affecting our belief systems in our country. And this this episode, Social Dilemma, was a 2 or 3 hour show. How many of you have seen it, by the way? Some of you have, and if you haven't, you should really make a note and check it out, because it will really not only show you the danger of these things, but give you a way to safeguard your own mind and filter what it is you see. And it's not just Netflix, it's some of these other things that I mentioned, but our core values have kind of changed in our country, and we can all feel, I think, that it's sort of pulling our country apart. You see this and feel it in politics, too. And I'm not going to get into that, but you might say, well, I don't really care about social media, I don't care about pop culture, I don't care. I don't really believe much about those things. But I want to ask you today what you do believe about Jesus Christ. Because he has a presence and a power in the world as well. He affects people's thinkings. What do you think about him? And it does matter what you think about him. Why does it matter? It matters because he's God. And it matters because he's the only thing standing between heaven and hell for you and for me. Because, see, we're all going to die one day, aren't we? Yeah, including you. Come on. You might think everyone in the pews next to you, it's going to be them, it's going to be me. But all of us, 100 years from now, I would guarantee that no one in this room probably is going to be here. You're still going to have a life, but you're going to be in a different place. We're all going to die one day. And actually, like I said last week, part of you lives on forever. So when you die, really, it's just your soul and your spirit are separated from your body. Your body is laid to waste and decays, but your soul and spirit live on. and it's going to go somewhere. And Jesus Christ makes a difference in where your soul is going to go, because part of you lives forever. And at some point in the future, you're going to stand before God. You're not going to have your mom or your boss or your best friend with you to comfort you or to be with you. You're not going to have your cell phone. You're not going to have anything. It's just going to be you standing before God himself. Now, you'll have Jesus Christ by your side if you knew him as your Savior. Amen? That's true. But we need to remember that he's the one that died on the cross for our sins. He's the one that rose again. We just celebrated that at Easter a few weeks ago. And so he makes you acceptable to God. And why does he do all that? It's because he loves us. He's our only hope to get out of hell and into heaven by believing and following him. And so he matters. And today we're going to talk about beliefs and what it is you believe about him. A lot of people, they believe they're going to go to heaven. Everybody wants to go to heaven, don't they? And a lot of people assume that they're going to go to heaven. Now, why do they do that? They say, well, it's because my parents were Christians, so that means I must be going to heaven. I'm an American, so that means I'm going to heaven. Or we compare ourselves to our neighbors. That, look at those creeps down this. Look at the things they do. I'm better than them. Surely I'm going to heaven. But I don't think that they are. I went to church and I went through a membership class, or I went through confirmation, and so that means I'm going to heaven. Steve Jobs said famously, everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die to get there. Yeah. Woody Allen said, I don't mind dying, I just don't want to be around when it happens. Mark Twain said, you go to heaven for the climate, you go to hell for the company. I hope he didn't really mean that when he said it. He was a, you know, sarcastic, cynical sort of writer. Sophia Loren, an old actress from back in the day, from the last century, she's still alive, she's still kicking and moving around, and she recently said, I know I'm going to heaven. I'm a good person. And see, some people assume they're going to heaven because they think they're good enough. They look back on their life and review all that they went through and say, well, I did this, I did that. Well, that wasn't too good, but I did a lot of other things. I must be good enough for God. I hope I get in. I'm a pretty good person. But like I said last week, good people don't get into heaven. Forgiven people get into heaven. We only get that through Jesus. He helps us understand the guilt feelings that we have and the challenges that we have as we face our relationship with God. So, see, there's lots of people that believe in God, but that doesn't get you into heaven. So belief is not enough. And we're going to talk about what a complete belief is and what the Bible says about that today. And so what you think about, inflation or the election coming up or Bitcoin or social media, those are all important subjects, but they're passing subjects. They're not going to matter at some point in the future. But what you believe about Jesus and your relationship with him does matter. So last week we talked about begin, didn't we? We said that people come to God all different ways. You may have had a childhood experience. You may have had a wild, wonderful, charismatic experience in some other place. You may have had a terrible tragedy in your life where you were broken. You found Jesus that way. But whatever it is, God wakes us up. Remember I said he wakes us up to himself? And we are sort of spiritually sleeping until God does the work of coming to us. We just sang the song in Waymaker. You keep working. You're always working. You never stop working. And he's working to bring us to that point, to wake us up so we will choose to respond to him, a free choice that we must make. But a lot of people around you have not made that choice yet. They're unbelievers. And like I said last week, you can't expect unbelievers to act like believers until they are believers. They're just not there yet. So you keep praying for them. On the way down here in the car, I was praying for traffic around me. I often do that. I see a lot of sad faces go by, or some people rushing and they're really in a hurry, or other people seem to be preoccupied. They're, eating a burrito or fixing their hair or doing all kinds of things in traffic. You've seen all that too, right? But I wonder, God, how many of these people are, how many know you? How many are believers? And how many are just going somewhere in their car, rushing somewhere to the next thing, and they haven't found you yet? Lord, reveal yourself to these people. You have lots of time to do that, sitting in traffic. And there are lots of cars around you rushing past. So most people don't know Christ. The way is narrow. The gate is narrow that leads to heaven. Broad is the way that leads to destruction. Many there are that are on it. That's the crowd. And they believe things about God or about themselves that aren't true. And so today we're going to be talking not just about the beginning. We're building onto that now with the next stage, which is about believing. The next step. And maybe you've struggled with belief in your life. But we're going to sort of unpack that today. So if you got a program, why don't you pull that out? It looks like this. And I have a separate insert today. A little more space for you to take some notes. So we'll look at point one today on the front. By the way, there's lots of space in the back. So if you get bored, there's room for tic-tac-toe there. You can draw a couple little pictures, whatever it is that'll pass the time for you. But let's look at point one today. What do Christians believe? What do Christians believe? And I'm going to give you some sub-points here in kind of a nutshell to sort of cover some basic Christian doctrine of what Christians believe, because the Bible talks a lot about our beliefs. And so point A, if you want to fill in the blank there, is this. God created us, and sin has tainted us. That's the first thing that Christians believe. God has created us, and sin has tainted us. So God created everything around us, right? Genesis is very clear in giving the account of how everything began. And as he created man and woman, he created them with free will, and they had choices to make in the garden. Eventually, they chose to rebel. They decided to live, I don't want to live God's way, I want to live my way. And because of that, sin cuts us off from God, doesn't it? Isaiah chapter 59, verse 1 and 2 says, God says, I can't hear you because your sin has cut you off from me. I want to hear you. I want to have a relationship with you, but you've put something up between you and me, and you have to admit that and surrender. The Bible says that all of us are sinners, and we've all come short of the glory of God, and the wages of that sin is death. And so we're broken until God finally reaches out to us, and then we must respond to him. But sin has tainted us, and it's not really going to be fixed until we get our relationship right with him. By the way, you know, the presence of sin is going to be with you and everyone in this whole world all the way through life. The penalty of sin and the power of sin was taken care of on the cross. But the presence of sin, the temptation for you to sin, is still going to be there all the way. You're going to have that battle. And the closer you walk to Jesus, the more you're going to have the victory. Even he was tempted in all points, like we are. But he was without sin. But even Jesus on earth in his earthly life bumped his nose up against temptation. Not wrong to be tempted. It's wrong to yield to the temptation. And we are to give those temptations over to the Lord. But sin has tainted us. Let's go to point B, and that's this. Jesus is God. This is what Christians also believe. Jesus is God. Turn in your Bible to John chapter 14. Now, we just heard from John, but he was reading 2 Peter. Don't get confused. Go to the book of John. John chapter 14. Jesus is God. If you don't believe that, you're not a Christian. You might believe something else, but you're not a Christian, because this is a must-have of Christianity. That's not me speaking and saying this. It's the Bible that makes this very clear to us. All religions are not the same. I have friends who are Jehovah's Witnesses. I have friends who are Latter-day Saints, Mormons. I have friends who are Baha'i. You know, those friends are very sincere about what they believe, and they work hard in their beliefs, but they are not Christians. They have a different Jesus than we do. They have different Bibles and holy books than we do. Jesus said there's one way to the Father. It's through me. And Christians believe that Jesus is God. Amen? It's just part of our basic belief. And so there are a lot of sincere but misguided beliefs out there with Muslims and Buddhists and Hindus and others. You know, I'm not judging these people. They just have a different set of beliefs than we do. Believing in Jesus as God is what makes Christianity distinctive. It's what sets us apart as that religion, Christianity. Christianity is classified as a religion, but it's really meant to be a relationship, personal friendship with God. The Bible says that Jesus is the invisible image of an invisible God, Colossians chapter 1. Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've also seen the Father. Now let me look in John chapter 14 and just read a couple of verses. Jesus says in verse 1, don't let your hearts be troubled. By the way, that means you can either choose to let your heart be troubled or not let your heart be troubled. He says, don't let your heart. Make this choice. Don't let your heart be troubled. He says, trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may be where I am. Skipping on to verse 6, Jesus said, they said, we don't know the way. And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. He is the only way to God, and he says later on in that chapter, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Jesus is God. He took your place on the cross. He rose from the dead. He lives in us by the Holy Spirit, and he empowers us to do the right thing. When you please Jesus, you are pleasing God. He helps us to do the right thing in our lives. There's so much more on that. We'll talk more about Jesus and his ability to change our lives as this series goes on. But let's go to point C, because I'm just giving you little nutshells of doctrine here. Point C is this: the Bible is true and relevant. So Christians believe God created everything, that Jesus is God, and that the Bible is true and relevant. It's our go-to book for answers. We get our encouragement and our guidance, our comfort. I got that from the Lord this morning in the scripture. I'm going to read for you a couple of verses from Hebrews chapter 4, which say this, starting in verse 12, for the word of the Lord is sharp and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to the dividing of soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give account. The Bible is different than any other book. It's a combination of the living word and the written word. It's not only old, ancient scriptures. It works in 2024. And if you have a problem with the Bible, you have a problem with Jesus, because he said that he's the living word. And the living word came to explain the written word. He is the Logos. He is the word. In the beginning was the word, John chapter 1, capital W. And the word was God. And the word was a God? No. That's where the Jehovah's Witness friends get it wrong. He was God. And so the Bible tells us these things that are true, so we can know the truth about God. Now, my parents weren't perfect growing up. They were great. But my dad, every morning, he would pull out the daily bread and put it on the breakfast table. We all had breakfast together. There were six of us kids. I had five sisters, no brothers, one bathroom. Probably feel sorry for me. I'm looking for sympathy here. But this is how we learned to read. Starting in 1956, when the Daily Bread first came out from Radio Bible Ministries, Grand Rapids, Michigan. How many of you have ever heard of or you read the Daily Bread? Yeah, I have a copy in my office back there. I was going to bring it up and wave one. You should have a stack in the back so you can take one home and that people can take one who are visitors here. Because I love to visit people's homes, bring a warm loaf of banana bread and also a daily bread. Here's some real bread and here's the daily bread. I should just read a little page. It just takes 5 minutes. And my dad would do that with us. And I did that with my sons and wife when they were growing up. That's how they learned how to read the English language, from the daily bread. You know, it's a simple thing to do. You can even get it in your app now on your phone. I listen to it sometimes when I'm driving or just having devotions with my eyes closed. It'll say the daily bread little saying to me. And the daily bread is powerful because it gives you a little bit of a grip on reality. It just points you the difference between right and wrong. And if you have a family, you got kids at home, it just takes a few minutes. Why don't you get one of those? Great way to start devotions in your family. And even with your grandkids, if you have an influence in their life. But the point in this section is the Bible is true. And it brings us back to what's true. In the middle of all the noise of pop culture around us, every day, we should read what's true and right. Let's go to the next point, and that's this, that God has the power to change people's lives. Now, there are a lot of Bible stories that demonstrate this. You know, you talk about Moses or David or Ezekiel, Mary, Abraham. These people were confronted with God, and he changed their life because they obeyed him and started to follow him or do what he asked them to do. And all through the centuries of Christian history, the last 2,000 years, we've seen many testimonies of people who have even died for their faith because their life was so changed, and they had an experience with God, and they began to come to church, and it was powerful. And maybe your testimony is the same way, where you see that God changed your life. Last week, I told the story about Stephen Gibson, one of the guys who came to our warehouse church, and he met Jesus, and it changed his life. And he went out and reached the wave of people behind him. And you have a lot of people that you know that are in your circle of friendships. And they need a friend like you and a church like ours. And this room could be filled with those people if they all would respond and come. Did you know that one of every three friends that you have would accept the invitation to come to church if you asked them right now? You don't have to be afraid. And if you already asked two people and they didn't come, you're going, oh, well, the third one's probably going to come. Because one out of every three will say yes to that invitation. But you could probably come up and tell how Jesus has changed your life. Again, that song, Waymaker, he never stops working. He never stops working in your life. He's the miracle worker. That's the power of Jesus Christ. You're not the same person you were before you met Jesus. You know that. Because he has the power to change your life. We'll have much more on this one next week. But do you remember when you said, I met Jesus, and everything's different now. And I'm not perfect. And I still make mistakes, but I see where my life is going now. I see the kingdom now. I have like the two sets of eyes that Pastor Mark talked about, with the little fish that can see above the water, and he can also see below. And now I see the kingdom of God. And I see life on earth the way God intended me to see it. To convert means to turn around and go in the other direction. When we're converted, that's what happens. Christ changes people. That Christians believe that. Look at point E, though, and that's this. We must determine to follow him daily. We must determine to choose him. Now, the power is there. God's put the power in you to follow him, but you have to engage that power. You don't just say yes to Jesus, okay, I waved my hand up, or I signed a card, or I walked forward somewhere, but now I go live and party like an animal, live any way I want to because I did that. No. This is you caring about a friendship. You don't make a friend with someone and then never talk to them again. The closer you get to that friend, the more you talk with them, the stronger that friendship becomes. It's no different with Jesus. And the more time you spend with him demonstrates that you're determined to walk with God. You're going to stumble along the way, aren't you? All of us have, because we're all sinners. Look at the next slide. We're going to read from 1 John chapter 1. Verses 7 through 10. Why don't you read together with me? Ready? Here we go. If we are living in the light, as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with each other. Come on. And the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we claim we have no sin, we are only fooling ourselves. But if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, and to cleanse us. If we claim we have not sinned, we are calling God a liar and showing that his word does not have its place in our hearts. And so God has done his part, right? He sent Jesus for us. He died on the cross, rose again, empowers us to do the right thing. He did his part. Now we have to do our part. And our part is to confess our sins and to stay in connected to the Lord Jesus Christ and to stay in step with him and obey him. And I don't care if you're the Pope or you're Billy Graham, we all are sinners and we all have to confess our sin and we all have to get back in step with him. And in fact, look, John even included himself. This is an apostle who says, if we confess our sins, if we are living in the light, then we have fellowship. Me too, John is saying about himself. He cleanses us from the sin. If we claim we have no sin, but if we confess, so he's saying it's everybody. We're all sinners, saved by grace. And every day you make thousands of tiny little choices. Some of those choices are about ambition, or about lust, or about pride, or lying, or anger, or fear, or impatience. And they're little tiny sins, but they add up to something. And if you don't clear the decks and confess them, then you're just moving farther away from Jesus. You know, the snowman thing I put up with the three things, well, the gate is closing, and you don't want that to happen. You want to keep that friendship open between you and the Lord. And that's, God did his part, and this is our part, to stay close to him. And also to stay positive. Say, thank you, God. Yeah, I made a mistake here. Please forgive me for that. But thank you for your power. And let's go do the next thing together, God. Keep speaking to me. Keep your Holy Spirit flowing into and through my life. And so Christians believe that we have to determine to walk with God. Now, that's the first five things. And if you open up your program to the inside, come on. I want to hear some pages rustling. Open it up. There you go. Good. Now, on the inside, on the left, it says a summary of what Christians believe. I put this in here because maybe you didn't know some of this. This is basic Christian doctrine, okay? And there's a 6 or 8 points here. It says not all the fine points of Christian doctrine, but it's the basics of what Christians believe. But look at me. Look up here. Don't read this now, okay? Go home and read it later. We're going to grind through the rest of the sermon. But I wanted to put that in there so you'd have access to that. And you may have a neighbor next door that's saying, what do the Christians believe? I'm not really sure about what they, well, here's my outline from a sermon that Pastor Mark had today. You can just read this and then they'll know what Christians believe. Okay? So it's just a simple tool for you to have a basic doctrinal statement. But I put that in there because today we're talking about beliefs. And so it's important. I want to ask you, though, do you believe those things? Yes. Not going to be answer all of it until you have read all of it. But they are basic Christian truths. But you know what? Even if you believe all those things, that's not enough. Even the devils believe and tremble. I mean, a lot of people that believe of God, they may believe, I believe everything on that page, but they haven't taken the step of faith. And that's what we're going to look at in point two, going from just beliefs to faith. Because, see, no one is born into Christianity. You have to choose this. Nobody makes you become a Christian. This is a voluntary choice that you made. Somebody came to you with the gospel, and you made the choice to choose that. You can't choose your race or the country you were born in or the family you were born in, but you can choose Christ. And we all have to begin somewhere, don't we? And when you go from belief to faith, you've begun a relationship with God. And you know, when you begin something, that ends something else, doesn't it? Starting something means that you just stopped something else. Every ending is also a beginning. You end something, you start something else. Even when your life ends, you end your life here, you're going to start another one in the next life. Kind of what we're talking about in this series. And so this is going from one step to another, and it's the same thing in Christianity, because your habits are going to stop and change and become something different. Your attitude is going to stop and change and become something different. Your relationships are going to stop and change. Now, on the other side of this page, I put a verse in here. Yeah, it's underneath point two there. It starts out, set your mind. I'm going to make you read this too. Make sure you stay awake. Okay, but because you know the language of English better than I do, probably, I want you to look at the verbs here and pay attention to the verbs. And I'm going to add a little emphasis to the verbs as we go through this, because verbs are words that are telling you to take some action and do something. So it starts with a verb, doesn't it? Set your mind. Let's read together. Here we go. Set your mind on things above. Next verb. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Come on, read with me. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but you now must rid yourselves, another verb, of all these things: anger, rage, malice, slander, filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you've been taken off of your old self with its practices and have put on the new self. See what that's saying there? You've taken this off and you've put something else on. Those verbs are action steps. And it tells us we've gone from our old beliefs to some new ones. We used to believe this, and now we believe that, and so we act differently. We've taken a step of faith. We used to follow like the world did, but now we've stepped out and taken a new step of faith. Let's take a quick look at a video clip that reminds you how important it is to take a step of faith. A little one-minute video.
Only in the leap from the lion's head will he prove his worth. It's impossible. Nobody can jump this.
Ah! Indy! And you must hurry! Come quickly!
It's a leap of faith.
Believe, boy. You must believe.
I know you want to watch the rest of the movie, but we're not doing that right now. But you see the point there of taking a step of faith? Why did he take the step of faith? Because he believed the book. The book told him what to do, even though he couldn't see it. He was challenged to step on. I don't want to spiritualize a film because this is Hollywood and everything, but you remember that scene from the movie and you can relate to it. And I can relate to it because it's taking a step of faith is taking a step into the unknown where we really don't know what's going to happen. And we gather our beliefs together and we decide what we're going to do, but and that's all good. We get the facts in order, but that last step is a step of faith. And it doesn't really make sense. And that's why the world won't go for it, because it's not logical. It's not empirical. It doesn't fit in Immanuel Kant's 13 categories of empiricism. I don't want to get all philosophical here. He was a Christian, but, you know, he said, I've done all this study of the world and all the facts I see, and there's no evidence to prove Christianity. And so he's sympathetic, but all the philosophers following Kant just attacked Christianity. It got worse and worse and worse. And so that last step can't be proven. It's a step of faith. And of course, Indy couldn't see it until after he had stepped out and gone across. And then he threw the sand back so he could see it as he went across the chasm later on, coming back. But I want to read for you from Hebrews chapter 4, verse 2, which says this, talking about having faith and belief. For we also had the same gospel preached to us as they did, but the message that they heard of was no value to them because they didn't combine it with faith. They heard the same gospel that we did, but because they didn't mix it with faith, it didn't help them at all. They wouldn't step out. They wouldn't act on it. They heard the same things. And I want to challenge you today, have you stepped out? Because belief comes from your mind, emotions, and will. But faith comes from your spirit. And that's how Jesus becomes real to you. That's why I put up the ABCD last week about how a person becomes a Christian. First, we admit. Then we believe. Everybody believes. A lot of people believe the things about God, but they haven't done this. They haven't taken that step of faith to actually call on the Lord Jesus. And then to determine to follow him and make that friendship a priority. And now as we finish today, I'm going to look at the passage that I chose, 2 Peter chapter 2 for the reading today. 2 Peter chapter 2, one of my favorite passages of Scripture and the whole Bible. Talk about this was a life changer for me. And we're going to look at this passage as we fill in the blank and do the final point today, which is this: belief and faith grow uphill. Take your pencil and fill in the blank there. Belief and faith grow uphill. 2 Peter chapter 1, starting in verse 3. His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness. All that you need for life comes to you from God's power. Through our knowledge of him who called us by his glory and goodness, through these he has given us his great and precious promises. So God, that's God's part. I have these promises for you, God says. I've done my part. I've promised you this. So that through them you may participate in the divine nature. In other words, another person actually comes to live in you. Another nature has come inside you. It's like a coach living inside you, helping you to play the game of life and do the best that you can, to participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption of this world caused by evil desires. Verse 5, here's the kicker. For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, to goodness knowledge, and then self-control, perseverance, and godliness. And the rest of the passage goes on. But here's my point. God did his part. He makes these promises. Here's our part, to make every effort to apply what God has told us to do. So God is going to test your faith. That's why faith grows uphill, because you're going to get tested. How else is God going to know if your faith is any good unless it gets tested? You go to school and you have an exam, and the teacher says, we're going to test what you know about math or science. And the reason they do that is because they have to find out how much you've learned. And God will test you too to see how much you've learned. You go to the doctor's office and they say, we're going to have to do some tests, because we have to find out what's really there. We have to prove what the facts are that are going on. On the racetrack, they test cars so they can really find out what its real strength is and how safe it is. Sometimes the emergency broadcasting system comes on. This is a test. For the next 60 seconds, you're going to be annoyed and hear a loud beeping sound just to prove that the system is working. See, there are all kinds of tests out there that we have to go through. And everyone's going into a problem, or they're in the middle, or they're coming out, and God uses those tests to see if you did go from belief to faith, if you really did step out to trust Him. That's why Jesus says in John 14, verse 15, if you love me, you'll obey me. So He's going to test to see if you really do love Him and you really will act on it. And you know what? When we're going through those things, the Holy Spirit comes to you and says, I know this is hard for you. I know this isn't easy. But I'm with you as you go through this thing. I'll help you. You know, maybe God brought you here today just so you'd hear that. That if you're in a test right now, God is saying to you, I know this is hard. I know it's not easy. But later you're going to see your faith is growing uphill. 2 weeks from now, we're going to do the next one of these, and we're going to talk about your behavior and how you go from beginning to believing to behavior and what that really looks like. But God did His part, didn't He? And He wants us to do our part, to make every effort to walk with Him. So where are you in this, on these five steps? Are you at this step of step five? You see, you need to decide if you've gone from belief to knowing Christ personally or not. Because like I said, one day your soul is going to separate from your body. And it's going to be too late then. If you don't know Christ as your Savior, you keep coming to see how these five B's work together. And don't put that decision off to know Jesus Christ as your Savior. Let's bow and pray as we conclude today. Father, how we thank You that You have shown Your love to us. You are a loving Father. You've made it possible, Lord, for us to know You personally and to have a way to understand what it means to live on earth and to live for You on the way to heaven. And I thank You for each person here, including myself. You speak to us, Lord, through Your word. And we pray that we'll accept the challenge of whatever it is You've said to us today. It's in Jesus' name we pray and for His sake. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Mark, for your powerful message on the steps in believing God. I'm here to do the offertory prayer, and thank you everyone who continues to give your tithes and offerings. There are three ways, I believe, to do that. I didn't know this, but one is there's a little QR code in the back of our program here. Scan it, and it'll take you to our giving page. The second is you can always mail it to CCC. And the third is there's a basket in the back where you can leave your tithes. So let's pray as we prepare to give our gifts to God. Dear Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for You in blessing us with our church family. And we are also so grateful for Your constant presence in our lives, and thank You for Your faithfulness. We acknowledge that every perfect gift in our lives is a gift from You, and thank You that we can always trust in You. You are an abundant God, and out of Your great mercy, You have given us so much. And as we bring to You our tithes and offerings, we give back to You from the abundant blessings You have given us. With it, we worship You and give our whole selves to You. Please take and use it for Your kingdom and Your glory, and may be a great blessing to many. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Join me this morning, if you will, in the pastoral prayer. Would you bow with me? Our Father in heaven, we thank you that we have the privilege of coming to worship and to remind ourselves and to speak aloud to say that you are our God and we love you. We have no other gods before you. We again surrender and submit our lives to you. And Lord, we confess our sin. If there's anything in our lives that isn't right, may your Holy Spirit bring it to our memory. Help us to be honest with you, surrender those things, and to know that then your Holy Spirit can shed his light on our path so we can walk with you in harmony. And Lord, there are needs in our congregation. I want to pray for Gon and for Chris that I visited this week with Lewis. They both face severe physical challenges, and they both had long and interesting lives. But we pray that you'll be with them in a special way with their limitations these days. We also pray for the Wong family in the passing of Hoy recently, a faithful member in the church. Bring comfort, Lord, and encouragement to that family. I know there are many others in the church that are facing emotional challenges or financial stress or physically in some way, or maybe it's just spiritually they feel dry. And we pray, Lord, that you'll be the refreshing God that we know that you are to each of us as we come to you, and that you will meet the needs of each of us in the ways that we need. We also pray for the state of Israel today. They're under attack, and there are many nations against them now. And we pray that you'll protect your land. We know you promise that you will. And we also pray for America, that we will be a partner of Israel, because in your word it says you'll bless those nations that bless Israel, and you'll curse those that don't. And we want your blessing, God, not just for us to be part of your, but also to be part of your strategy for peace around the world, and to use whatever power or influence we have for good, to bring freedom and to help other nations as they desire that. And so thank you, Lord, that you're sovereign over the nations. We pray these things, thanking you that we can come to you in prayer today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
So I'll stand. We're going to sing our last song, Come Thou Fount.
Come Thou Fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing Thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, all for souls of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, mount of thought.
standing, please, for the benediction. Will you pray with me? And Lord, a final prayer. We do pray today for Terry's nephew's sister-in-law. There's a tiny baby in the family, Sophia, born with a heart defect, and a second child they've had with that. And we just pray that there'll be healing there. Pray that you'll give comfort to that family and that they'll feel the presence and power of Christians praying for them and God's comfort around them. And Lord, we all need your comfort as we leave this place. We need your guidance. We pray that you'll bring to memory the things that we need to apply from our time in church today with you as we go from here today. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And the believing people of God said, amen. God bless you. Have a great day.
Come thou fountain.